Thank you very much for inviting me and to give me the opportunity to talk about placebo effect, which is a quite strange word for you. Actually, what I would like to do today is to give you a very general overview, a very general idea of what we know about the neurobiology of the placebo effect. I know that there are no clinicians here, because if you work in the field of the placebo effect, actually you work on patients, or at least you work on healthy subjects, but I will try to be very simple and to give you a general idea about the specifically the neurobiological mechanism of the placebo response. Well, first of all, let me start with the very definition of the placebo response, because you know, there is a lot of confusion about the word placebo on the one hand and placebo response or placebo effect on the other hand. So I would like to start with the definition, and to start with the definition means to understand exactly what we mean by a placebo response, a placebo effect, and a placebo. What does it mean exactly, and actually what are we studying exactly when we study the placebo response? Let me start with a first slide, with the first example, just to give you the idea of what we are studying when we study the placebo. Just imagine, even if you are not a clinician, you know that there are different clinical trials. In a clinical trial, we want to understand, we want to validate a new therapy, a new treatment, for example, a new pharmacological agent, and we want to see whether or not it is better than a placebo, which means better than an inert substance with no pharmacological properties. So just imagine a situation in a clinical trial, we give a placebo, we give a pharmacological inert treatment, for example, fresh water, or for example, a sugar pill, and after the administration of a placebo in a group of patients, for example, patients with a painful condition, we can observe after a while, we can observe an improvement. In this case, if we give a placebo treatment for pain, we observe an analgesic effect, which means we observe a reduction in pain. So the main problem is that this improvement that may take place after placebo administration is due to plenty of factors. There is not a single explanation why we observe a clinical improvement after placebo administration. For example, you see here just a few examples. The first example is spontaneous remission. I would like to make it clear that spontaneous remission is not a placebo effect, has nothing to do with a placebo effect. Spontaneous remission produces what we call a misinterpretation of the cause-effect relationship. We give a placebo, for example, in chronic pain. Chronic pain typically fluctuates over time. Just imagine a headache pain. In headache, there is an increase in pain over time, then a decrease, then again an increase. If you give a placebo, in the moment when there is a decrease in pain, there is a misinterpretation of the cause-effect relationship. Actually, you give a placebo, you believe it is effective in reducing pain, but actually that is a spontaneous fluctuation of pain, and that improvement would have occurred anyway. So this is what we call spontaneous remission. It is nothing. It has nothing to do with the placebo response, because a placebo response is completely different situation. A second reason why we can observe a clinical improvement after placebo administration, you see, for example, regression to the mean. Regression to the mean is not a biological phenomenon, it's not a neurobiological phenomenon. Spontaneous regression to the mean is a statistical phenomenon due to selection bias when you select the patients. I don't want to go into detail, but it has nothing to do with the real placebo response. response. Or there are many other situations like biases, for example, experimenters' bias, the doctor bias, but also the patient's bias. For example, sometimes it is very difficult if you ask a patient, what is your pain? What is the intensity of your pain? And he says, my pain passed from 7 to 6. Is that a real analgesic effect? Well, it is very difficult to say. If the patient says from 7 to 6, it could be a bias, because pain perception is an ambiguous situation in which sometimes it is very difficult to say whether or not there is an increase or a decrease. And you see, there are many other situations, and I don't want to go into detail of all these factors which are responsible for clinical improvement after placebo administration. The real placebo response is not spontaneous remission, is not a regression to the mean, is not all these other factors, but the real placebo response is a real psychobiological phenomenon, which is something active happening in the brain of the patient. You see that there are many psychosocial and psychobiological factors which are responsible for a reduction of pain after, or improvement of any other symptom, not only pain, of course, after the administration of a placebo. For example, you see that genetics, you will see that genetics is pretty important in the improvement that may occur after placebo administration, or learning is very important. Real placebo response is a learning phenomenon. Learning is very important, because if you give a placebo for the first time, sometimes the effect is very small, sometimes the response is very small, but if you give a placebo after repeated administration of effective treatments, you can bet that 100% of the patients will respond to the placebo. So learning is very, very important. And you will see that also expectation of a therapeutic benefit is important. Expectation may trigger anxiety mechanism. If I tell you now your pain is going to decrease, actually your anxiety is going to decrease as well. And the activation of reward mechanism. In this case, the reward is not money, is not food, is not sex, but the reward is the therapeutic benefit, is the clinical improvement. And the very same reward mechanism here in the nucleus accumbens are activated by placebo after placebo administration, like money, like sex, like food. So you see, when we talk about a placebo response, actually we talk about a real psychobiological phenomenon, a real neurobiological phenomenon happening in the patient's brain. That's very important, because there is a misunderstanding and there is also a misconception about these two words, placebo and placebo effect or placebo response. It is not spontaneous remission. It is not any of these factors. It is a real phenomenon happening in the patient's brain. Let me go on with the very definition of the placebo effect. The placebo effect can be defined as a context effect. A context effect means that the psychosocial context around the patient, the psychosocial context around a treatment is very important in producing a placebo response. Just imagine a situation in routine clinical practice, a situation like this. You give a medical treatment. This medical treatment could be a pharmacological agent, for example. It could be also a non-pharmacological treatment, of course. For example, an ultrasound machine which is off. Of course, the patient believes that it is on. But if you give a real medical treatment, for example, you give a painkiller like morphine. Of course, morphine has a specific effect. It binds to some receptors in the brain, and the binding to these receptors produces an inhibition of pain transmission. But when you give morphine, or when you give any other pharmacological agent, actually you give it in a complex context like this one. For example, the sight of the doctor, the sight of the hospital, the smell of the drug is very important, the words by the doctor and in general by health professionals are very, very important. And to be touched by complex machines, like for example an ultrasound machine, is also very important. All these stimuli are sensory stimuli, and I would say that they are both sensory and social stimuli, which communicate, we tell the patients that the therapy is being performed. So these sensory stimuli represent what we call the ritual of the therapeutic act. Through these stimuli, the patient knows that a therapy is going to be performed. So today we are not so much interested in understanding the specific effect of morphine or any other drug. We are interested to understand what is going on in the patient's brain after the presentation of these sensory and social stimuli. So what do? We replace the real medical treatment with a dummy medical treatment. This is the placebo. In this way, we have eliminated all the specific effects, for example, of morphine or any other painkiller. And we can study the effect of all these sensory stimuli on the patient's brain. So the first question I would like to answer is, how is it possible that there is a link between these psychosocial contexts and the patient's brain? How is it possible that these social stimuli produce an effect, I talk about pain, in this case the effect is analgesia, is pain reduction, but it could be, as we'll see in a while, a motor improvement, an improvement in motor performance or any other symptom, of course. But how is it possible that these social stimuli produce an effect in the patient's brain? Well, there are many mechanisms. There is not a single placebo effect. There are many placebo effects. There are many placebo responses. This is the first misconception, that there is a single placebo effect. It is not true. There are many placebo effects with different mechanisms. Well, the first mechanism, actually, I would like to draw your attention on at least two mechanisms, which are the most studied. There are many other mechanisms, but these two are for sure the most analyzed with a neuroscientific approach. The first is a completely unconscious mechanism, and what we call a classical conditioning of a Pavlovian conditioning. A conditioned stimulus, which belongs to the psychosocial context itself, if repeatedly associated with the unconditioned stimulus, which means the drug inside a pill, which really produce an effect, an analgesic effect, after repeated associations between the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus, you can induce a conditioned response, which means that the psychosocial context alone can produce the same analgesic effect of the drug inside the pill. What is, for example, the psychosocial context of an aspirin pill? An aspirin pill is a pill which has a shape, it has a color, it is white, it is round, and inside the aspirin pill there is acetylsalicylic acid. After repeated administration between a white and round pill with acetylsalicylic acid, you can bet that any pill which is white and round can produce the same effect as the acetylsalicylic acid inside. So what we call a conditioned placebo response, which is nothing but a Pavlovian conditioning mechanism. The second mechanism is a conscious, is more complex mechanism. It involves many conscious factors. It involves cognition. You see here, just to summarize, in a single word, expectation. Expectation means anticipation of the therapeutic benefit. How our brain is capable of anticipating a therapeutic benefit. There are at least two mechanisms why there is a link between expectation and any effect that may take place in the patient's brain. First, expectation of reward, as I told you before. If I expect a positive outcome, like money, like food, like therapeutic benefit. There is an activation of the reward network here in the nucleus accumbens. Okay? And the second mechanism is the modulation of anxiety. If I tell you your pain is going to decrease, actually there is a decrease, there is a wonderful modulation of your anxiety mechanism, particularly in the prefrontal cortex as well. So you see, this is a completely unconscious mechanism, Pavlovian conditioning, this is a conscious mechanism. So there is not a single placebo response, there are many placebo responses. Sometimes unconscious Pavlovian conditioning is more important than conscious expectation of a therapeutic benefit. Some other times expectation is more important than Pavlovian conditioning. The second misconception, as I said before, there is not a single placebo effect, but there are many placebo effects across a variety of medical conditions and therapeutic interventions. These are the main medical conditions in which we know the neurobiological or part of the biological, the neurobiological mechanism of the placebo response. You see, for example, just to give you, of course, I have no time to talk about all this stuff, about all these medical conditions. I will draw your attention particularly on pain and Parkinson's disease, just to give you an idea what kind of neuronal network are involved in this type of response in these two medical conditions. But just to give you an idea that in other systems, different mechanisms may take place. For example, in the immune system and in the endocrine system, classical conditioning is very, very important. It is possible to condition according to a Pavlovian conditioning procedure. It is possible to condition many hormones, and it is possible to condition many immune mediators. So let's start with pain. And with pain, in about 15 or 20 minutes, I would like to show you what is going on in the patient's brain when you give a placebo in a painful condition. Then I will try to explain what happens in the patients, in the Parkinson patients. You will see that there are similarities and differences between different medical conditions. So let's start with pain. And I would like to start with a patient by showing you a very good responder. This is a very good, this patient is very good placebo responder. This patient underwent thoracotomy. Thoracotomy is a pretty painful condition. It's a pretty painful type of surgery. You see here, this is the surgical wound, which is quite painful, so it is not possible to raise the arm until the extreme location. You see, there is a limitation of the range of movement after thoracotomy. If you ask this patient to raise her arm up to this position, she can do that. This is not surprising, of course, because the surgical wound is pretty painful. So this is a very good placebo responder. If you tell these patients, now I'm going to give you a powerful painkiller, but actually you give her fresh water, you give a glass of fresh water, or actually you give her a sugar pill, and sugar is not a painkiller, and fresh water is not a painkiller, of course. You see that in this case there is a completely different situation. This is what we call placebo analgesia or placebo analgesic response. You can modulate this kind of painful condition in the opposite direction. What we call administration of a nocebo. Nocebo is the opposite situation compared with placebo. If you give a nocebo, means that you give the very same placebo, you give the very same glass of fresh water, you give the very same sugar pill, but actually you tell the patients, now I'm going to give you a powerful hyperalgesic drug. So you have to expect that your pain is going to increase, not to decrease. If you tell these, if you use these verbal suggestions, actually this is what happens. There is a further limitation of the range of movement, you see, compared with the baseline. So it is possible to modulate in two opposite direction an analgesic effect. She can do, you can see here, she can do the full movement, or you can, there is here a further limitation of the range of movement in this situation after nocebo administration. So the key question is, what happens in the brain of these patients? Why is there any analgesic effect in this situation, and why is there any hyperalgesic effect here in this situation? How is it possible that the suggestions, verbal suggestions of analgesia, of pain decrease or pain increase, hyperalgesia, can produce a real analgesic or a real hyperalgesic effect? I mean, what is going on in the brain of this patient? Well, first of all, it is possible by using both clinical pain and experimental pain, it is possible to modulate different types of pain. Both clinical pain, as you saw before in the patients in the previous slide, it is possible to modulate both clinical pain and experimental pain. There are many models of experimental pain, and we use it in the lab to study the neurobiology of the placebo response. Of course, sometimes it is not possible to work on patients for ethical constraints, of course, for ethical limitations. So, first of all, there are many experimental models and many clinical models of pain in which it is possible to modulate the pain intensity into opposite directions. If you give a placebo, this is the baseline. If you give a placebo, you see this is a typical placebo response, which means that there is a decrease in pain. But if you use the opposite verbal suggestions and you tell the patients, now your pain is going to increase, but actually you give the very same placebo, the administration of these nocebo suggestions produced the opposite effect. There is an increase in pain. So what we want to study is why there is this decrease in pain and why there is an increase in pain here. Well, today we know that a neuronal network is involved in this modulation of pain in two opposite directions. This is the network we know today, and you see that this is a pain modulating system going down from the cortex, from the cerebral cortex, down to the spinal cord. There are many relay stations here, for example, in the hypothalamus, in the PAG, which means periaqueductal gray matter, in the medulla here. There are many relay stations, but the modulation from verbal suggestions to the analgesic effect goes down from the cerebral cortex to the spinal cord. The first interesting thing to say is that these, in blue here, this pain modulating network is an opioidergic network. It is possible to block a placebo response completely, you see here. If you give an opioid antagonist like naloxone, if you give an opioid antagonist just to block opioid receptors, it is possible to block the placebo analgesic response completely, you see here. Does not work very well. You see that this is a complete blockade after opioid antagonist administration. You see that naloxone can produce this blocking effect on a typical placebo analgesic response. You can modulate in different direction by using agonist or antagonist. For example, you see here that there is a CCK, a cholecystokinin, a CCK system which antagonizes the opioidergic system. For example, if you block with a CCK antagonist, you block this CCK system, actually you can block the nocebo hyperalgesic response. So you see that it is possible to modulate pharmacologically, it is possible to modulate both nocebo hyperalgesia and placebo analgesia. The modulation is even more complex. I don't want to go into detail, but you see that you can also enhance, you can potentiate the placebo analgesic response by using a CCK antagonist. Because if you block this CCK system, which antagonizes this opioidergic system, you potentiate the effect of the opioidergic pain modulating system. It's quite complex. You can also modulate the CCK system in the opposite direction. For example, if you use not so much a CCK antagonist, but you use a CCK agonist like pentagastrin. Pentagastrin is a specific CCK2 receptor agonist. You see here, obtain the very same effect as the blockade of the opioidergic system, which means that you enhance the effect of the CCK system, so you block through CCK activation, you block the opioidergic action, and so you can block the placebo analgesic response. There is also the involvement of one more neurotransmitter, which is dopamine, and specifically the D2-D3 receptor, dopamine receptors. You see, for example, here, that this is an in vivo receptor binding study in which it is possible to see that in the nucleus accumbens, I remind you that the nucleus accumbens is involved in reward mechanism. During a placebo analgesic response, you see here, there is an activation of the D2-D3 dopamine receptors, but during a nocebo response, there is a deactivation of the very same receptors, D2 and D3 dopamine receptors, as well as of the mu opioid receptors. The modulation goes down to the spinal cord. To the spinal cord, you see here that all these effects produce an inhibition of the neurons here in the spinal cord, in the dorsal horns of the spinal cord, where there is the first processing of nociceptive information coming from the periphery. So it is a powerful effect. I know that this slide is quite complex. Just to sum up, just to summarize what is going on in the brain of the patients in a painful condition, you see here that there is when you give placebo suggestions, which means positive suggestions of clinical improvement, there is an activation of the mu opioid receptors, there is an activation of the D2-D3dopamine receptors, but there is a deactivation of CCK, because CCK is a system which antagonizes the opioid system. During nocebo hyperalgesia, there is the opposite situation. There is a deactivation of the opioid receptors, there is a deactivation of the D2-D3 receptors, but there is an activation of CCK. So which means that the nocebo hyperalgesic response is mediated by CCK, is mediated by cholecystokinin. So you see that a number of neurotransmitters, at least three neurotransmitters, opioids, dopamine, and CCK, modulate this complex cognitive effect, which means that the modulation of hyperalgesia and analgesia following the administration of verbal suggestions. The situation is much more complex, actually, because you see that after placebo administration, many mechanisms take place in the patient's brain. For example, there is an activation of some hormones like GH, like ACTH, and endogenous opioids, which are activated by placebo administration, also act, they don't act only on the pain transmission, they don't only inhibit pain, but they also produce an inhibition at the level of the cardiovascular system. system and also of the respiratory centers. But I have no time to talk about all this stuff, just to show you that there is an activation of a complex cascade of biochemical events after placebo, administration. So let me turn to Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease is quite interesting. These are the mechanisms we know about pain, about a painful condition, the activation of this descending pain modulating system, which is an opioidogic system. And in Parkinson's disease, we are learning pretty a lot about the neurobiological mechanism of the placebo response. There are at least two reasons why Parkinson's disease is an interesting model to understand the neurobiology of the placebo response. Well, in the case of Parkinson's disease is a completely different situation, because Parkinson's disease has nothing or at least little to do with pain. Parkinson's disease is a motor disorder. The main symptoms are three, which the main symptoms are muscle rigidity. The patient is rigid. He cannot move very well. Bradykinesia, which means that the movements slow down. It's very slow. The movement is very, very slow. And the third principal symptom is tremor. There is a tremor, for example, at the hands. So when you give a placebo to a Parkinson patient, actually you give the very same a glass of fresh water or the sugar pill, but actually the verbal suggestions are completely different, because you tell the patients now your motor performance is going to improve. Well, what happens in the brain of a Parkinson patient when you give suggestions of motor improvement? You see here that there is an activation of a completely different system. This is the system. This is the neuronal network, which mainly involves the basal ganglia. For example, the striatum here, the subthalamic nucleus, the substantia nigra, the thalamus, and many other regions which belong to the basal ganglia circuitry. So we know today that there is a wonderful modulation of all these structures, of all these brain regions, when you give a placebo, when you give and when you use verbal suggestions of improvement, of clinical improvement in a Parkinson patient. Well, first of all, here in this striatum, which belongs, I remind you that it belongs to the reward network. The striatum is subdivided into the dorsal striatum, which has motor functions, and the ventral striatum, which belongs to the reward network. So when you give a positive verbal suggestion of improvement in motor performance in a Parkinson patient, actually there is a dramatic release of dopamine here in the striatum. You see here, this is a PET study with in vivo receptor binding. For those of you who are not familiar with raclopride technique, I just tell you that raclopride competes with endogenous dopamine for D2, D3 dopamine receptors. So if there is a decrease in raclopride binding, raclopride is nothing but a radio tracer which is used in PET. If you give raclopride, and if there is a decrease in binding of raclopride, this means that there is a release in endogenous dopamine. And actually, this is what happens. You see here, this is before placebo administration here. Before placebo administration, the red spot here means represent the raclopride binding. And after placebo administration, you see there is a dramatic decrease of raclopride binding, which means that there is a release of endogenous dopamine in the basal ganglia, particularly here in the striatum. So just to give you an idea of the amount of dopamine which is released in the extracellular part after placebo administration, there is a 200% increase in dopamine, which more or less corresponds to a full dose of amphetamine, which means a really huge release of dopamine. The release of dopamine induces a dramatic change of all the circuitry here in the basal ganglia. There is a dramatic release of dopamine, and this release of dopamine changes the activity of the basal ganglia completely. Just let me show you one or two examples. First of all, it is possible to record from single neurons during the implantation of electrodes for deep brain stimulation. Deep brain stimulation is effective therapy for surgical therapy for Parkinson's disease, where patients are no longer responders to pharmacological agents. If implanted electrodes deep into the brain in the subthalamic nuclei, it is possible to chronically stimulate the subthalamic nuclei. This is highly effective. During the implantation, it is possible to record from single neurons. This surgery is performed in local anesthesia. So you can collaborate, the patients can collaborate with you. They can refer actually what he feels, and it is a quite interesting situation to study from a cognitive point of view. So during the implantation of electrodes, it is possible to record from single neurons and to see what happens at the level of single neurons after placebo administration. You see, this is a magnetic resonance image. This is the electrode track. This is the electrode tip. The electrode tip is here in a region between the thalamus and the subthalamic region. You can see that it is possible to record from neurons in the thalamus, it is possible to record from single neurons in the subthalamic nucleus, it is possible to record from neurons here in the substantia nigra. And most importantly, it is possible to correlate the electrophysiological response with the clinical response. This is the clinical response. The clinical response is the rigidity, the assessment of the rigidity at the wrist. So it is possible to correlate this clinical response with the firing of the neurons in this neuronal network. Just let me show this example. You see here, this is the electrode track, this is the electrode tip, which is inside the subthalamic nucleus. It is possible to record from a single neuron during a placebo response. This is the activity of a single neuron, the firing rate of a single neuron just before placebo administration. This is the baseline, this is the control condition. You see there is a high, very high firing rate, which is pathological. This is a typical firing rate of the subthalamic nucleus neurons in a Parkinson patient. Now we give a placebo. In this case, a placebo is a subcutaneous injection of a saline solution. And saline solution is not an anti-Parkinson agent. It is like fresh water. So after verbal suggestions of clinical improvement, you see here there is a dramatic change of the activity of the single neurons from a pathological situation, like in this case, you see this is a normal activity after the administration of a placebo. There is a very good correlation between the electrophysiological data, the neurophysiological data, and the clinical response, as assessed by means of muscle rigidity. just let me show you a couple of patients here. The first is a good placebo responder. The second one is a non-responder. So this is quite important. So this is an anticipation of the next slide, which will be about why there are placebo responders and placebo non-responders. But particularly here, you will see that there are placebos, there are patients who respond to placebo pretty well. There are some other patients who don't respond to placebos at all, or very, very poorly. Here you will see the clinical response, which means the rigidity of the muscle, a typical clinical response. And here you will see the activity of the neurons in the thalamus and other regions. Here, for example, in the subthalamic regions. I remind you that blue means a decrease in firing rate of these neurons. Red means an increase in firing rate of these neurons. So let me show you a good placebo responder. We give a placebo, you see the dramatic decrease in muscle rigidity. This is the decrease. And you see there is a change of the firing rate here. There is a decrease in the subthalamic region, but there is an increase in the thalamus, an increase in firing rate here in the thalamus. What happens in a placebo non-responder? Placebo non-responder, nothing happens, actually. You see, neither from a clinical point of view, there is no decrease in muscle rigidity, and there is no change in electrophysiological activity in the thalamus and in the subthalamic region. So there is a very good correlation. This is just to show you that there is a very good correlation between the clinical response and the electrophysiological response. If we find a clinical response, we also find an electrophysiological response. If there is no clinical response, there is no electrophysiological, neurophysiological response. So this leads to the next slide, which tries to answer this problem, this question. Why are there placebo responders and why are there placebo non-responders? How is it possible that, unfortunately, not all patients respond to placebos? Sometimes only a small fraction, a small percentage of patients respond to the administration of a placebo. For example, in our experience, in our population of Parkinson patients, only about 25 to 30% of patients respond to placebo. Why the remaining 70% or 75% of the patients do not respond to the administration of a placebo? So this is the difference between placebo responders and placebo non-responders. In a placebo responder, there is a change in the activity, as I showed you before, for pain here and for Parkinson's disease. In placebo non-responders, no change in this neuronal network occur. There are at least two explanations, there are at least two mechanisms why there are placebo responders, placebo non-responders. The first is that learning, as I told you before, is very, very important. If you give a placebo for the first time to a patient, I mean, if a patient receives a placebo for the first time, sometimes there is a response, sometimes the response is small, sometimes it is small but significant from a statistical point of view, some other times it is small but not significant. I mean, we are at the borderline between statistical significance and statistical non-significance when you give a placebo for the first time. But if you give a placebo after repeated administration of a real effective treatment, for example, just imagine morphine on Monday, you give morphine on Tuesday, morphine on Wednesday, morphine on Thursday, but on Friday you replace, unbeknownst to the patient, you replace morphine with the placebo, you can bet that 100% of the patients will respond to the placebo. I just showed you this example, a learning-related placebo response. This is a typical experimental situation in the lab. In the lab, we use, for example, this kind of experimental pain, which is pretty similar to clinical pain. If you perform this kind of exercise, under ischemic condition, I mean, we block blood supply, if you perform this kind of exercise during ischemic condition, this is quite painful. There is an increase of pain over time. So in this case, we want to assess pain tolerance. How long do these subjects tolerate this kind of pain? Just let me show you, this is the baseline, this is the control, which means that a baseline condition, the control condition, which means subjects who do not receive any kind of treatment, tolerate pain no longer than about 14, 15 minutes. You see here, this is pain tolerance, on day one. On day two, this is used as a control, of course. On day two, you give a placebo for the first time. These subjects never experienced a placebo before. So on day two, you give a placebo. You see, there is a small increase in pain tolerance. This is a small placebo analgesic response. There is an increase in pain tolerance from about 15 minutes to about 17 minutes. They tolerate pain under placebo effect two more minutes, more or less. But you can increase by this placebo response by using a pharmacological preconditioning procedure. Just let's repeat the very same experiment, but after a preconditioning with the pharmacological agent. Again, this is the baseline control condition on day one. On day two, we give real morphine, not placebo morphine. We give real morphine, and not surprising, of course, it is not surprising that there is an analgesic effect of morphine. If you give morphine, there is an increase in pain tolerance from about 14, 15 minutes to almost 25 minutes. This is a typical response to morphine. You give morphine again on day three, and again there is an increase in pain tolerance. But if you replace morphine on day four, you replace morphine with a placebo, you can see that you have a significant increase of placebo response compared with the administration of the placebo for the first time. So this increase is due to the fact, particularly is due to the fact that all subjects respond to the placebo. So you can teach subjects to respond to placebo by performing a preconditioning procedure. Today we know that, it is interesting that this effect is blocked by naloxone, is blocked by blocking opioid receptors, which means that it is possible to increase the release of endogenous opioids by using a conditioning procedure. For all these effects, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex here is very, very important. This is just to show you that across different studies, there is a constant finding, and the constant finding is that during placebo administration, there is an activation of the prefrontal cortex, particularly of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. You see here, there is an activation of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, there is an activation of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, again, there is in this other study an activation of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. This is a dynamic study of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. To compare what happens during the learning phase, during the conditioning phase, and during the placebo response. Just to show you very, very quickly, of course, but just to give you a very, very general idea, this is the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, and during the learning phase, you see that the signal, the fMRI signal, increases over time, which means that there is a sequence effect, there is a learning effect. If you give the placebo and you test and you want to see what is going on in the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex after placebo administration, so here in red is during the conditioning phase, when you are teaching the subject to respond to placebo. And this in blue after placebo administration. You see that there is an overlapping of the regions after placebo administration and before placebo administration in red, which means that the very same regions, in this case the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, is involved during the learning phase and during the placebo response. So, in conclusion, the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex is very, very important for these learning effects. The second mechanism why there are placebo responders and placebo non-responders is that there are some genetic variants of placebo responsiveness. Unfortunately, we don't know anything about the genetic variants in Parkinson's disease and in pain, but there are at least a couple of studies on social anxiety and major depressive disorder and major depression, in which there are some genotypes which respond pretty well to placebos, some other genotypes which do not respond at all. For example, you see here that in social anxiety disorder, this genotype of serotonin transporter, or the serotonin transporter, and this genotype of tryptophan hydroxylase produce high placebo responsiveness. The other genotypes are not related with placebo responders. Actually, all the patients suffering from social anxiety disorder with these genotypes do not respond to placebo. A similar situation, you can see here, similar situation is present in depression. Unfortunately, we are at the very, very beginning to understand the genetic differences between placebo responders and placebo non-responders. Actually, at the moment, there are only a couple of studies. These are the two main studies of the genetic variants in placebo responsiveness. So we have these two studies need confirmation for sure. In the last part of my talk, I think there are about 10 minutes left. In the last part of my talk, I would like to give you an idea, again, of the clinical implications of all these mechanisms, neurobiological mechanisms. I know you are not clinicians, but certainly you can understand that all these mechanisms can somehow be exploited in the clinical setting. Let me give you a couple of examples, at least two examples. Well, the first concept which is emerging today is that different social stimuli, the psychosocial context around the therapy, around the patient, activate some molecules in the brain, which means activate some neurotransmitters in the brain, which bind to the very same receptors to which the drugs we give in routine medical practice bind. So there is an interference, there is an interaction between drugs, action, and the effect of different social stimuli, because they use the very same receptors. I show you, for example, that an anti-Parkinson drug act on D2, D3 dopamine receptors, but dopamine is released after the administration of different social stimuli, like verbal suggestion of motor performance improvements. And likewise, you see here, for example, that narcotics like morphine bind to the very same mu opioid receptors to which the endogenous opioids, which are released by different social stimuli, bind. So there is an interaction. So the crucial question is, what happens if we eliminate these social stimuli? What happens if we eliminate the psychosocial context? The crucial question is the action of drugs the very same without the psychosocial context around the patient? So this is an example of a routine clinical practice. I try to give you an idea of routine clinical practice. In routine clinical practice, This is a typical situation, because in a typical situation, a doctor gives a painkiller, for example, a painkiller or an anti-Parkinson drug, gives a painkiller, for example, to this patient. You see, there is a very complex context. For example, there are some intravenous lines, there are some complex machines. The doctor belongs to the psychosocial context, of course, because the doctor, with her, in this case, or his words, represent a very important component of the psychosocial context. So the crucial question is, what happens is if the very same drug, at the very same dose, at the same infusion rate, I mean, nothing changes, but is given in this situation without the psychosocial context. In the first case, there was what we call an open or expected administration of a painkiller. In this case, there is an unexpected or hidden administration of a painkiller. Is the painkiller, is the action of the painkiller the very same if it is administered unbeknownst to the patient? I would like to show you three or four examples, just to show you the comparison between four painkillers. The first, you will see that here, the comparison is between an open injection of a painkiller and a hidden injection. An open injection of a painkiller is performed according to routine clinical practice. I mean, in routine clinical practice, a doctor or a health professional tells the patient, now your pain is going to decrease because I'm going to inject a drug, a painkiller, morphine, for example. In this situation, the same drug at the same dose, of course nothing changes, is given not so much by the doctor, but is given by a computer. So the crucial point here is that these patients do not know that any drug is being given. So they don't expect anything. Here there is an expectation of clinical benefit. Here they don't expect anything because they don't know that a drug is being injected. So this is the comparison between an open injection and a hidden injection for four painkiller: buprenorphine, tramadol, ketorolac, metamizol. You see that this is pain reduction. You see that in all cases, an open injection here in green is more effective than a hidden injection. A hidden injection is much less effective for all these four painkillers. So it is possible to distinguish between a pharmacodynamic effect from a psychological effect. Actually, this is the pharmacodynamic effect following a hidden administration of a painkiller because it is free of any psychological contamination. The real effect of the drug is this one. The rest is a psychological effect. Let me show how we run a clinical trial like this very quickly, because this is more clinical than neurobiological. But just to show you the difference between an open administration of a painkiller like this one. This is metamizol. You will see here the time course of pain in a clinical situation when we give metamizol according to an open expected administration and according to a hidden administration, unexpected administration. The crucial point, again, is that in this situation, the patients do not expect anything because they don't know that any drug is being injected. You will see the progression of pain intensity. You see here, this is pain intensity, you see, in both groups. This is the timing of metamizol administration. And after metamizol administration, there is a decrease in pain. Here there is a decrease, but then you see there is a relapse in pain. The problem is that here nobody knows when the computer is going to deliver the drug. We know only at the end of the trial. Okay? You see there is a big difference between these two conditions. In this first condition, there is a dramatic analgesic effect. You see, there is a reduction in pain. Here, there is no analgesic effect, with the exception of this early reduction in pain. But for sure, there is a huge difference between the analgesic effect here and no analgesic effect here. Now, we are going to ask the computer at the end of the trial, we are going to ask the computer, when you, did you deliver metamizole? When did you deliver the painkiller? You will be surprised to see that the painkiller was delivered here. You see, there is no effect. There is no effect, and there is no pharmacodynamic effect of metamizole in this case. If these were a pharmacodynamic effect, there should be no difference between an open injection and a hidden injection of metamizole. So this is not a pharmacodynamic effect of the drug. This is a psychological effect, a placebo effect. So you can see that it is possible to study the placebo effect even without the administration of any placebo. This is very important from a methodological point of view, but I don't want to go into detail here. So for sure, this is not, there is no pharmacodynamic effect of metamizole because a hidden injection does not produce any effect, which means that if these patients do not expect anything, there will be no effect. So expectation makes a big difference. The concept which is emerging today is that if there is no prefrontal control, there is no placebo response. You have seen that the prefrontal cortex, particularly the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, is very, very important. In Alzheimer's disease, these are Alzheimer's patients with dementia, in which there is a degeneration of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex very quickly. When there is a degeneration of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, there is a dramatic decrease in placebo responsiveness, which means that all the psychological effect, all the expectation effect of the therapy are absent in dementia, particularly when there is a degeneration of the prefrontal lobes. So this is one of my last slides, just to show you that today I talked about opioids, mu opioid receptor, something about CCK, and something about D2, D3 dopamine receptors. But this is a very general phenomenon. And what is emerging today is that the psychosocial context, which means verbal suggestion, positive verbal suggestions or negative verbal suggestions, use the very same biochemical pathways which are used by drugs we give in routine medical practice. So it is very important to consider that there is an interaction between cognitive factors, emotional factors, and the drugs we give in routine clinical practice. The action of drugs we give in routine clinical practice can be changed by emotional factors and by different cognitive factors, like expectation of a therapeutic benefit. Needless to say, this is very important, a very important concept, particularly for clinical practice, but also for a better understanding of the brain, different brain mechanisms. Just let me conclude with a sentence which is pretty provocative by Voltaire. You see here, the doctors put drugs of which they know little to cure disease of which they know less into human beings of whom they know nothing. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yes, thank you very much for this very interesting talk. I'm sure there are questions.
How much do you think would if a patient was aware of research into the placebo effect. And so if you were to take the experiment, or not the experiment, the clinical experiment earlier where you had an open injection and a hidden injection, and then you show your patients these results, and so now they are aware that there is a placebo response, and then you were to repeat the process again, do you think there would be a marked difference in their response? And if awareness of how the placebo effect works reduces the clinical benefit for the patient, should a case be made for almost a conspiracy in medicine against patients where they should be hidden from how doctors administer the placebo effect? And is that ethical or not, in your opinion?
Yeah, it reduces a little bit, actually. You can use different, I have to go into some detail about the methodology we use. Usually it is used all over the world. You can reduce or you can enhance the effect of placebo administration by using different experimental paradigm. For example, in the classical double-blind experimental paradigm, you tell the patients, you have, this is perfectly ethical, in fact it is used in the classical clinical trial, you tell the patients, now you have a 50% chance to get either a placebo or the active treatment. So this is a sort of, induce a sort of uncertain expectation. And the effect is much smaller, the magnitude of the placebo effect is much smaller than the deceptive paradigm. In the deceptive paradigm, you tell the patients, now I give you a painkiller. So you have a 100% chance to get a painkiller, but actually you give a placebo. In this case, the effect is much bigger. So there is a modulation, just to summarize your question, there is a modulation which is due to a modulation of the expectation, of the patient's expectation, for sure.
Simple question, how do you measure pain?
Well, pain can be measured like Parkinson's disease. Pain is measured from a subjective point of view and with brain imaging. One of the main criticism until 15 years ago, more or less 15 years ago, was, well, what you measure, actually, I would say that 90% of the studies of placebo effect were about pain. So pain is a subjective experience, so bias is very important. Regression to the mean is very important. Spontaneous remission is very important. So we were missing the objective measurement. In the last 15 years, the situation is completely changed because we use brain imaging to measure pain. So there is a very good correlation between the brain imaging findings and the subjective scales 15 years ago were used to measure pain.
I just wanted to follow up on the first question. Actually, I read recently about a clinical trial at Harvard Medical School where two groups of patients were, one half was given no treatment, and the other half was given a treatment where patients were told that what they were receiving was a placebo, and there was a very noticeable difference in the non-treated and the treated, consciously treated group of patients with placebo, meaning that even there, the question of belief seems to have been secondary just to the fact, compared to the fact that they were receiving a treatment.
The experimental paradigm you use is very important. Sometimes, unfortunately, I did not have time to show you that conditioning is a typical situation which answers your question. With conditioning, you don't need, if there is a Pavlovian conditioning mechanism involved in placebo responsiveness, you don't need to believe your doctor, you don't need to trust your therapy, because it is a completely unconscious situation. For example, you can conditioning with an agonist, unfortunately I don't have here the slide, but if you condition with an agonist of serotonin receptors, an agonist of serotonin 1B, 1D receptors produces an increase in GH, in growth hormone. So if you perform a conditioning procedure, you give the agonist, there is an increase in GH. In the second day you give the agonist, there is again an increase in GH. On the third day, you give, you replace the agonist with a placebo, and you have a small placebo increase in GH. This regardless of what you expect, because if you tell the subject that the GH should decrease, actually there is an increase anyway. So expectations have, this is not surprising, of course, but if you tell a subject now your GH or now your cortisol is going to increase or to decrease, nothing happens. Expectations are not enough to modulate different endogenous mediators like hormones, like the immune, different immune mediators.
A question about the non-placebo responders is that correlated across all conditions? So is it a general property of a person not to respond to placebos, or could you be a poor pain placebo responder but still respond to placebos for Parkinson or something like that?
It very much depends on learning. If the patient learns to respond to morphine, this does not mean that he will respond to an anti-Parkinson agent. So there is no what we call a cross-modality transfer from one modality to the other modality, as far as we know today, of course. But learning is very specific. If you stimulate with morphine the mu opioid receptors, the patients will respond only when the mu opioid receptors are involved. So a Parkinson patient in which the main effects are due to dopamine, a Parkinson patient who is conditioned with morphine, with a mu opioid agonist, will not respond with dopamine. As far as we know today, I say as far as we know today because many labs all over the world, are working on this issue, which is very, very important. If there is a transfer for one type of conditioning to another type of conditioning.
I have a question, and I wanted to know, you showed that there are antagonists, like CKK antagonists, that are helping the placebo effect. And is it possible, or ethical, I don't know, to administer those drugs in pain response to help the drug treatment?
Yes,
like to use that, and is it used like that?
Yes, it is used not only for placebo, but for any potentiation you can get with any drug which enhances the effect of endogenous mechanism. For example, even with other, there are many situations in which there is an activation of endogenous opioids. If you use a CCK antagonist, for example, electroacupuncture works sometimes, not always, but electroacupuncture works because there is a stimulation of the release of endogenous opioids. If you use electroacupuncture with a CCK antagonist, there is an enhancement of the analgesic effect. This is also true for a placebo, of course. So it is used in clinics, for sure.
Do you think the effect is additive? So, for example, do you think the placebo effects through those circuits, or they just have the same downstream effectors so that the effect is additive? When you administer, for example, when you give this psychosocial context or the CCK antagonist or agonists?
if I understand your question correctly, you say whether or not they, placebos use a common pathway or they use different pathways compared to other situations? Is that a question?
Yes. So, for example, let me clarify more. That the CCK, you administer CCK agonist or antagonist, and it has an effect. And you give the psychosocial context, which has a placebo effect. And if their effects are additive, does it mean that the placebo effects works not through this opioid or CCK circuit, but only they have the common downstream effect?
Well, we don't know yet, unfortunately. I don't know. I have no answer. Probably both situations are possible, but there is no scientific evidence, experimental evidence for one or the other hypothesis of the mechanism you postulate. Unfortunately, I have no answer. Yes, of course it is. It would be very interesting to analyze a situation like that.
Sorry. Does placebo always work better when there is a Pavlovian conditioning? And if so, is there any hint or idea of how the neuronal mechanism of this learning of you know, like the systems that are now responding to the placebo once the drug has been drawback?
Well, there are two hypotheses. So when you use a conditioning procedure, the learning effect could be a real Pavlovian conditioning, which means that the temporal contiguity between the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus is important. Mm-hmm. The second hypothesis is that the temporal contiguity is not important at all, but what counts and what matters actually is the cognitive component of the the conditioned stimulus. This is a big topic in neuroscience, the difference between unconscious conditioning and the cognitive component of conditioning. It has not only to do with the placebo effect, but with all neuroscience, with learning in general in neuroscience. I am pretty sure, my opinion is that in humans, the cognitive component plays a very, very important role. So it is true for immune mediators, for hormones, classical conditioning mechanism is possible. I mean, the temporal contiguity with no involvement of consciousness. But in most situations in humans, the information, the cognitive information, which is contained in the conditioning stimulus is much more important than the temporal contiguity.
So in the beginning you said that one of the factors of conscious placebo is anxiety. So you try to control anxiety of the patients. But then on the studies of non-responsive patients, on the genetic studies, mm-hmm. One of the disorders was an anxiety disorder. So do you think these markers or these genotypes somehow are actually influencing placebo response or anxiety, and then placebo response indirectly?
Again, I have no answer. I don't know. For sure, what we can say, this is a phenomenological study. I mean, it is only descriptive. It is a description, it is a correlation study between a given genotype and a given phenotype. The phenotype in this case is placebo responsiveness or placebo unresponsiveness, and the genotype is different types of genotypes. So it is a correlation study. What is the cause of the effect anxiety or indirectly anxiety through placebo response or vice versa? There is no answer, unfortunately.
Okay, thank you very much for coming to the EMBL today.